Beyond and hello, everyone. My name is Jonathon Dornbush, and I have a little bit of bad news about this week's episode of Podcast Beyond. It's still ahead of you if you're watching the video version of this. Obviously, you see there is, you know, definitely a bit of an episode ahead of you. But unfortunately, when we were recording roughly the first half of the episode or so, maybe even a little bit more, the video version of it didn't quite save. The file didn't quite work the way we would hope it would normally. Computers, isn't it wonderful? So unfortunately, for the first half of this episode, we don't have video of Brian, Max, and myself, who are the cast for this week's episode. It does kick in a little bit later in the show. We'll try to put a timestamp in the description so you know when that kicks in, because if you're really just in it to look at our beautiful faces, you'll be able to jump ahead. But please listen for the rest of the episode. There's a lot of really, really great discussion in that bit that will be audio only, and the rest of it will kick into video in the later half. We apologize for the inconvenience for that. We will be back in full video form, computer willing, in weeks to come. This is not a sign that we're going audio only again, just some technical difficulties this week. We hope you can understand, though, and in the meantime, enjoy this episode of Beyond. Beyond and hello, everyone. My name is Jonathon Dornbush, and this is Podcast Beyond, episode 697 of IGN's weekly PlayStation show, where we have a lot of PlayStation news to talk about this week. So without further ado, I think we should jump right into it. We're joined this week by Brian Altano.
PlayStation news.
And Max Scoville.
Yes, it's back. The news.
there we go.
About the world of the PlayStation.
We're off to the races. I love it. No, there's actually quite a bit to talk about this week, including some surprising turns by Sony, some leaked information about maybe a Sony PlayStation Pass, but not a Game Pass that you might be expecting, some initial thoughts on Returnal and a lot more. But let's jump in with the biggest decision of the week that Sony has publicly made, which is that they have announced that they are reversing course on the PlayStation 3 and PlayStation Vita stores, and they will continue to sell games on those stores after all. Jim Ryan, in a blog post on the PlayStation blog, announced that they reversed course by saying, quote, "Upon further reflection, however, it's clear that we made the wrong decision here. So today I'm happy to announce that we will be keeping the PlayStation store operational for PS3 and PS Vita devices." PSP will also be closed, though, on July 2nd as planned. When we initially came to the decision to end purchasing support for PS3 and Vita, it was born out of a number of factors, including commerce support challenges for older devices and the ability for us to focus more of our resources on newer devices where a majority of our gamers are already playing. We see now that there are many of you are incredibly passionate about being able to continue purchasing classic games on PS3 and PS Vita for the foreseeable future, so I'm glad we are able to find a solution to continue operations. So I wanted to bring this piece up and get your feelings on it. I think there's I think we can all agree, a good move. A few weeks back, Brian, we definitely were refraining about how this just sucked, this decision. I think it comes with some caveats that we can get into, but I appreciate seeing this because I like, especially in an era where, you know, Xbox, I think pretty dominantly and regularly is a voice on social media, is like there is an Xbox social voice and like a platform that we hear from them. There's Phil Spencer that we look to and all these things. PlayStation doesn't really have that right now. And so when we get these more human moments, like after the PS5 pre-release debacle where they put out a tweet and we're like, yeah, we messed up, we're sorry about that, and something like this, I wish we saw more of that, because I like when they show that there are humans behind these decisions.
Yeah, I think you're completely right. There has obviously been a lot of discussion about this. We were very vocal about why this sucked. And I think it's like the big thing was that, like, I personally don't have these old systems hooked up. I'm not rushing to re-download those games, but there's millions of people that do. And I think it's important to speak on behalf of those people, to have empathy for those people. Like, this is not like, I don't think this is the saving grace for the future of classic games on PlayStation. In fact, this sort of leads me to believe that maybe they don't have a backup plan for this stuff. But in the interim, like, this is awesome news. And it's also proof that, like, you know, I don't want to say that, like, complaining works, or that it's worth, protesting every single thing that a company does or having fan petitions for everything. I think that, you know, that can get a little dangerous here and there. But in this situation, people threw a fit and it worked. Like, this is in the same way that a couple of weeks ago, you know, there was that rumor going around, or no, I think Xbox specifically said, hey, we're raising the price of games with gold, and everyone threw a fit. And then they came around the next day and said, sorry, you didn't like that. We're not going to do that. It's important to do that. And I think, like, a lot of people told us, what are you making a big deal about this for? Who cares? Sony obviously ignored those people, which is great because those people can shut up. And I'm glad that they listened to the people who said, I want to keep buying classic games. And they made it easier for them because, you know, people were trying to download these games or having trouble accessing the store. There was like a lot of problems that people were having with like sort of connecting and purchasing these old games again. People just want like a console that has a bunch of old stuff on it that they can play, where they don't have to worry about DRM and internet connectivity and batteries and all this other stuff. You know, we are all like kind of mild doomsday preppers when it comes to digital hoarding. And we want to be able to play our old games. So I'm really happy they did this. This is awesome. I hope it's a step forward for the future where they can bring more of their old games to modern platforms.
Yeah, and Max, I know you weren't around for when we had sort of the initial beats of these, but I'm definitely curious to hear how you felt about like this reversal sort of situation.
Well, I mean, yeah, there's the ongoing discussion about sort of archival of games and how it's how do you legally play old games, you know, like if they're hard to track down, if the original costs $1 million, like the obvious solution to that should be like legal ways to purchase things digitally. And it's really cool to see Microsoft doing that and being like, hey, you want to buy like, you know, original Xbox games, we're doing everything we can to port that stuff over, you know, make it, you know, more accessible to people. And I don't know, I feel like Sony especially has like a rockier track record in terms of backwards compatibility, which kind of compounds the issue further. Having stuff on digital is, I guess, one way to circumvent that. But like, I don't know, there's a handful of games that you currently, if you like actually sit down and kind of, you know, do the research, it like really, really good games that you cannot legally play except on like PS3 or Vita. Like, I think we did that. We looked into that at one point and it was like the best way to play Metal Gear Solid is either, aside from, you know, pirating it or, you know, getting the PC version or whatever, is the PlayStation Classic, which is not a good way to play it, or getting it on PS3, like the original PlayStation 1 version. And it's like, that's such a, you know, an important game. It's kind of crazy to me that they would even consider being like, well, there's no alternative, you know, like if they had an alternative sorted out, then great. But like, just to completely shut down an entire sort of corner of, you know, that infrastructure, it seems like, you know, a little bit short-sighted. So I'm glad they reversed that. Mm-hmm. For sure.
Yeah, it's a weird situation because there's so much, not just of the PlayStation 3 era locked to the Vita and PS3, but also those classics, because they did such an effort to bring PS1 and PS2, you know, digital downloads as an available thing on the PS3. But you look at things, especially within just, I think we talked about this a few weeks back, but within even just like the PlayStation, you know, history, we're on the cusp of a new Ratchet and Clank. And if people are relatively new to Ratchet and Clank, it's like you can play the PS4 one and subscribe to PS Now to play some of the old ones, but not all of them. Otherwise, you need to have a PS3 or a PS Vita. And it things like the Infamous franchise, you can't really get on PS4. The Resistance franchise people love. Metal Gear Solid 4. Things are just locked to that system mostly.
Yeah.
And go ahead. Sorry.
No, it's just that PS Now, I think it's a decent make good for now, no pun intended, but it still does have the barrier of a lot of the games are locked to streaming only.
Yep.
Which means that you need a pretty decent internet, which, you know, much of the world still doesn't have at that level yet. So I think it's like there are some Metal Gears on there. There are ways to play them. I think people just like having a game downloaded that they can play.
Yeah, I think the important thing about this, and I think what we're all responsible for to a certain extent, and Brian, I do want to point to what you were saying about how, like, you know, there can definitely be ways where conversations around these sort of like fan movements go wrong. And I'm sure there were people who, when this announcement came out, were like, I want to go, like, I'm going to go yell at all of the Sony devs and much worse things that, you know, I don't even want to say because people can go a little overboard on social media. Mm-hmm. There are definitely, you know, bad tones of conversation that can happen. But I feel like the general tone was, again, not to keep coming back to it, but this just sucks. Like, it was a genuine sadness that I think everyone had at this news.
Yeah. Yeah. And a bunch of us got called like Xbox fanboys for pointing out that old games are cool because, you know, Xbox has had this like sort of like concurrent ideology of preserving older games. And that's a part due to the architecture of their backwards compatibility. But it's also because it's just, you know, I'll say this, I don't think they have a ton of modern games pumped out constantly. So they're sort of like a quantity over quality company. And I think PlayStation has both. You know, there's a lot of like really awesome classic PlayStation games, and I hope they keep coming back. It's crazy to me that this story keeps popping up. I know people are sick of hearing about it, but I wanted to speak on what you said earlier about the sort of the brand having a bit of a human identity. That's a tough sort of like tightrope to walk on, right? It's a tough balancing act. Yeah. But I do think you're right. Like we don't have a Sean Layden anymore. And like Herman Hulse is, you know, very busy. I think quietly toiling way behind the scenes, and, you know, Shuhei doesn't pop up very often. We've got Jim Ryan, who has been, you know, maligned by a lot of the audience recently. If you look at even yesterday, not to get political, but the Derek Chauvin trial happened and PlayStation chimed in. Like, I don't think it's necessary for a brand to chime in on every political, you know, scenario. I think a lot of people want to keep those things separate, but I personally think it was cool to see something like that happen, for them to sort of like have their finger on the pulse of something that's like a little bit more human. There's a lot of intersection between so racial disparities in gaming. There's a lot of racism that happens in online gaming. I think it's important to have that conversation, and I think it's important that they were at the forefront of it. I think it's great that they can come out and say, hey, we're sorry we screwed up about this thing, or we messed up pre-orders, or, you know, we listened to your feedback. Like, that's what people are looking for now.
Saying yes, this thing is on, and yes, we hear you. Going back to the game side of things, we just got Astro's Playroom, which had this entire wonderful like victory lap of all the history of PlayStation stuff, and there's all these, you know, you go and collect all these old systems, you go and get the Vita, you get the adapters for the PSP and all this stuff. It's kind of messed up that comes out and be like, oh, you're feeling all these things, oh, you recreated the PlayStation 2 intro, that sound brings me back. And then they're like, yeah, no, we're they didn't pay their power bill, we're cutting them off, you know. It's
yeah,
kind of like,
no, you're totally yeah, right, you know?
Yeah,
we mentioned this a couple weeks ago too, that like that game is an absolute love letter to the deep history And the oddities too, the failures along the way that created the PlayStation brand that we know and love today. And that was, to me, one of the, you know, flagship sort of launch softwares for the PS5. It's the best-selling PS5 game. and to take that and sort of just like brush it aside instead of, you know, cherish this, the foundation and the history that brought you to where you are, was crazy to me. So I hope we kind of see a little bit of a renaissance around that.
Like I totally get them wanting to move forward and wanting to like be like, hey, look at the shiny, sexy new things. But like, you can't maintain a fandom and a community around if you ignore that entirely, you know?
Yeah.
Like that's why bands do reunion tours. That's why, you know, like, you know, greatest hits tours or whatever. Like that's why, you know, I wouldn't even call it straight up nostalgia in this case. It's more like just having, you know, having these fundamental things available, like not just being like, oh, that's our, you know, this juvenile crime, we'll put it under the record or whatever.
Go ahead, Brian.
No, I was just going to say real quick, these like tiny releases like that, just drag, you know, not, I don't want to say dragging and dropping because it's obviously a lot more work than that, but taking a classic vintage PlayStation game and throwing it on PS Plus or just putting it out as part of the state, you know, play at home initiative, anything like that, is the thing you do in those like quiet winter months between, you know, Miles Morales and Demon's Souls and Returnal and Ratchet and Clank and all the other big tentpole games. Like, I like that idea of having the system not just be something that is designed to play flagship AAA first party games and like, you know, the best third party games and stuff like that, but also like, you know, kind of peppering the experience between these big things with little snacks that are classic games that we grew up playing.
We had that weird stretch on PS4 where they started dropping in some like old PS2 games, and it wasn't like remasters. It was just like, oh, hey, like you can get, you know, Star Wars Bounty Hunter or Racer Revenge or whatever, and it was like it seemed like that was the beginning of something new or something, or like that was going to be the norm, or they were going to start kind of being like, hey, we're slowly making sure the archive works on here, we're moving it over, you know, that the PS3 is complicated because of cell architecture or whatever, but here's some PS2 stuff. And then it just stopped and it just disappeared, like we don't have that anymore. And it's, I don't know, meanwhile over on the Xbox side of things, they're like, hey, everybody, here's an Indiana Jones game from when you were in high school. Have fun. There's a new one coming eventually.
Well, and and speaking to that, like there was definitely an era in like the middle of the PS4 where like the Jack and Daxter games were available and Psychonauts came out. And I was like, yeah, I'm going to buy these games. They have trophies, but also I want to play these games. And it's I totally had that same thought of like, oh, maybe they are doing this thing. And at the end of the day, like this initial decision, it's very clear from what Jim Ryan was saying, like was made because it was a money thing. And, you know, it probably didn't hurt that the dedicated PlayStation fans immediately went and bought as many PS3 and Vita games as they could. They probably were like, oh, we can keep that going for a little bit. Mm-hmm. But at the end of the day, like as cynical as it is, it's like there's so much history there that we can't access. But if you made it available even to rebuy, like at this point I'm at, like from PlayStation, I'm asking to go the Nintendo route and make me rebuy my childhood, because like at this point I think backward compatibility for those previous gens feels like a lost cause. I hope that's not the case, but it feels like it. And so if you put up all these classics, like I would buy them. And just to circle back to the beginning of this before we move on, like again, I think this decision is great to see, and it is thanks to, I think, the pressure that, you know, a passionate fandom did put on in, I think, a relatively respectful manner here. But the thing is, there's no, like the language that's used is, this is not in perpetuity. This is not forever. There was not, and we're figuring out a way to bring these games to the PS5 or even the PS4. Like this is a stopgap temporary extension, essentially. And at the end of the day, they are still going to close those stores. And at least for now, we don't know if they have a, but also we're going to do this. And I like the lack of a, but here's what else we're going to do is, I think, the thing that worries me the most, because at the end of the day, I'm happy to see this and I'm happy that people still have a chance. And I literally bought a Vita charging cable because I couldn't find mine over the weekend so that I could buy games just in case. And then, of course, this happened. But it's one of those things where like that's going to be an announcement later on in the future. Like we're going to get these stores shutting down. And I just hope we find a workaround. Again, as Brian was saying, PS Now is potentially the place to go, but we don't even have an indication of where that's going. Sorry, Max, go ahead.
I was gonna say, like, I remember hearing that when the PlayStation 2, I think it was, I don't know, it was ended production or if it like ended support, whatever the official term for it, basically they're like, we're putting, you know, the final nails in that coffin. That is no longer a thing that we're supporting. You can still buy them, plenty, they're out there, there's tons of them. I'm sure there's people, you know, selling used games and all that. The key difference is that was entirely physical games and hardware and everything, and in this case, like, it's digital, so it's entirely ephemeral. Like it's I feel like it's almost on them to kind of maintain that, unless there's, and there's not, there's no way that some third part, like good old games isn't suddenly going to be compatible with like your PS3. Like you're not gonna be able to like download, hey, I'm gonna download this old game from, you know, from 1998 because I feel like it, and it's not, the money isn't going directly to Sony. Like they have complete ownership of that. And you know, it's the same. We see this deal with Nintendo, but they're much better about like putting out older stuff or being like, hey, you're going to buy it again because you love it. But the internet side of things is really weird. Like we've seen huge chunks of sort of, I don't know, internet culture sort of evaporate because that's how the internet works. It's kind of a shifting, you know, sand dune of content. But it sucks when it, with games specifically, because like that's an art form, that's a medium, that's a huge chunk of history that effectively, you know, is gonna disappear, and there's gonna be no like simple way of retrieving that stuff.
Mm-hmm. I totally agree. I think that there's sort of a fallacy that these efforts take away resources from development of new products, and I think that's fundamentally untrue. I mean, it's not like Horizon 2 is going to be a smaller game because somebody at Sony has figured out a way to port a Ratchet and Clank game, right? Like I don't think it's not like that. It's not like you're laying everything on the table and you're like, we can only make what we can make out of these things.
Hey, Mark Cerny, can you take a break from the PlayStation 6 you're prototyping and help us port over Shadow Tower or whatever? Like,
yeah, exactly. That, and like to what you mentioned before, Jonathon, I think that like it's not just about backwards compatibility. A lot of people bring that up and they go, oh, if you look at the statistics on BC, it's not actually used all the time. And it's one of those things people fight for but then don't actually utilize. That's not necessarily, I think, the only method. I think that we've weirdly conflated this conversation to be just around backwards compatibility, which I think is a door that's been closed for Sony for some time now. And like we mentioned a couple weeks ago, mostly due around the elephant in the room, which is the PS3's sort of weird cell architecture, which was sort of a pain in the ass for everyone to deal with. But there are other ways to play games on a console that aren't just, you know, native backwards compatibility. And like you said, Nintendo, you know, resells them to you. They also put some on their Nintendo Online. Like I wouldn't be against buying a bunch of PS1 games for $5 or $7 each. You know, we'll see. I feel like we talk about this story a lot. And I'm glad that it's the gift that keeps giving and that like Sony's come around on it. I want to see what's next. I want to see what the future of the past means for Sony, you know, because hopefully they do have a solution down the line.
Do we have any new games to talk about?
We don't. Like
nothing. Yeah. None at all.
Yeah, making those these days?
I've been playing. I've been playing a lot of Final Fantasy I, the original game. We do in fact have a new game to talk about because I have played a bit of Returnal and so has Simon Carty, and so I would encourage you to definitely go to IGN.com. Simon turned around a really great preview for Returnal. It's a written and video preview, so you can check it out on IGN as well as YouTube.
Does he like it?
He does quite a bit, and I share a lot of similar feelings with him. I was going to say he said I could if I wanted to read it word for word, but I prefer Simon's voice to my own, and so I don't want to butcher his words with my voice. So I'm just going to talk about...
He has a better British accent than you do.
He definitely does, yeah, yeah. Mine is just an Austin Powers riff, so I mean, yeah, it's definitely better. Anyway, so yeah, I have played a little bit of Returnal. I can only talk about some of the like early goes of it, and again, definitely recommend checking out Simon's piece. I'll give sort of my like brief overview, and then if you guys have any questions about it, please feel free to ask. But
I do.
it's so far I really really like it. It is initially giving me, so like Hades was my game of the year last year. I am not a huge roguelike person typically. There need to be hooks that keep me going, that keep me interested in it. Otherwise, even if there's some mechanical stuff that carries over, if there's not more of a through line, I kind of get bored with roguelikes very quickly. And here there is a pretty good blend so far of the mysteries of what the hell is going on with Selene, the astronaut you play, as well as Atropos, the alien world you're on. And, you know, I'm still so early on, so much of it is still a mystery. But like, I've died now a couple times, as you're supposed to. And I want to keep going to find out more about this world, not just because I feel like I have to. Like, I really am enjoying the loop of discovering more about this world. And part of that is due to like, obviously, we've seen from trailers and stuff, this is such a blatant love letter to, for me, the two things that it feels like is like, if Metroid developers could make a modern day Metroid that was completely in love with Alien, like if they could just really lean into the, I knew this was probably going to, you know, be the buzzwords to get you guys on board.
Yeah.
But yeah, it feels so much like a little bit of a modern day Metroid mixed with, you know, a clear love of Alien. And I love being in this world already. It's so spooky and gross, and you can hear the aliens in the distance occasionally, and you're like, you're both fearing of stepping forward, but knowing you have to, but also wanting to. It's that really great combination of like fear, but the impulse to keep exploring, pushing you on. The thing about the gameplay, it takes, I think, Housemarque's sort of traditional arcade style shooting and adapts it pretty well so far to third person action. You can you know, aim down the sights or just free fire aim. The game is pretty generous in letting you, as your free fire aiming, still be able to keep your eye on enemies and everything. The only sort of weapons I've gotten to go with so far are like a pistol, a carbine, and a shotgun, essentially. But each of them can have different attributes. They can have different special alt firing weapons, and some of those are like you shoot a bomb that explodes, or you shoot these like a line of horizontal blasts that start ricocheting all around the room until they hit enemies. There's like a bunch of different things that you can randomly come upon, because essentially the only thing you start out with at every run is your pistol, and then from there you get what you get as the runs go on. There is equipment and abilities, like you get the ability to sort of like fast travel from certain locations to the next that carries through, and so there are mechanical things that do carry through. Before I get too deep in the weeds on that stuff, and if you guys have questions on that, it'll probably help steer me. The one thing I absolutely want to call out that I am like in love with is this is a PS5 exclusive, and it is immediately making use to me of really fun ways, the DualSense and the 3D audio. Like if you have the option to play, if you have a PS5, of course, and you have headphones that work well with the 3D audio, play this with headphones. It is so, so immersive in that sense of, like I was saying, like you hear the creepy aliens moving around you. You hear the foliage moving as you go past it. The rain and the way it falls down on the planet, it feels like it's coming all around you, mixed with the DualSense feeling like rain, kind of like it did in Astro's Playroom. But it does this really cool thing where you're typically playing in third person. If you hit the touchpad to go into the menu, it brings you into sort of Celine's like map view and like her data bank and everything, with the presumption in my head that you're looking through her eyes. So you're in first person. And so the rain suddenly gets muffled and it's like it's hitting her helmet, and it's a little bit more,
okay.
It goes a little bit more quiet and like softer, not softer, but like the thuds are more noticeable. Whereas when you're in this pulled out view, the rain is much more all around you and more encompassing. And so it's using little tricks like that. It's using, there's an opening cutscene where when Selena is first crash landing, the way the lightning ripples both around you in the audio and through the controller, or an asteroid spins by your ship and you hear the audio of it going past you. Like it's using all those little tricks that are, you know, we've talked about like what's a gimmick and what's immersive. You could fundamentally play the game without those things and you'd still be playing a very good game, but it just so absorbs you into the world. Like from minute one, I was like, oh, I want to be in this world.
It reminds me a lot of the sort of elemental visor details that they tucked into Metroid Prime, where it's like, this is not the reason I'm playing this game, but this brings so much atmosphere to the table. I wanted to ask you, so I think I realized like that I really like roguelites and roguelikes. And it's one of those things where I've always been like I prefer deliberate level design over sort of like chaotic, spur of the moment, procedurally generated stuff. But more and more, I just dump tons and tons of hours into games like Undermine and Dead Cells and Hades. And I'm like, oh, I guess this is my jam. Like, I didn't even realize this. But a thing that really hooks me about those games is there is that notion of like, I drop into this hole, I do everything I can, I die, but I do bring some stuff up back to the surface that sort of lets my character grow and evolve and build and upgrade. And I find new weapons and items where when I go back down, I feel a little bit more powerful, a little bit more equipped to take on whatever's next and kind of like go deeper and deeper into the hole. Is that like kind of a loop that you feel like at the core of Returnal is there? Like, does that grab you in the way like it does with a great roguelike?
Totally. I think there is, I think I'm only scratching the surface of it. And again, I'm still really early on and can only talk about that early stuff. So I'm curious to see how it goes through. But yeah, essentially, so what happens is every time you die, you end up back at Celine's crash site and your ship is there and you can go into the ship, check out your database, and also take on daily challenges, which are apparently in there, but I haven't gotten to take a look at. And this sort of, you have this repository of information, which, to go back to like the Metroid analog, reminds me a lot of Metroid Prime and wanting to scan everything to learn about this world. Like, you know, audio logs and scanning things is a dime a dozen in games, but I think the way it's integrated here works really well and keeps me wanting to know about those little tidbits. Like I said, your arsenal, like your weapons, those are things that you are picking up as you go. But so far, like in the footage that's on the screen right now for video viewers, and I'll describe it, Celine like is in her typical sort of like space setup. At one point you'll get basically an augment from like alien technology that just is then permanently on her suit and will permanently be with you. So there are things that you will be permanently picking up. It's not weapons per se, but I do get the sense that there will be bits of it that do carry through the whole time. And I want to know what those are more, because I'm definitely with you. I love when they connect you through to that. And I think that's going to be what changes this from, oh, I'll play this for 10 hours to I'll play this for 50 hours sort of thing, you know?
Right.
And so I've only scratched the surface of that, but it does feel like there is enough there. There are things like you pick up a currency to, you know, add more health per run or add more weapon proficiency per run. That stuff resets. If you pick up keys to unlock certain doors, those reset. But like both your knowledge of the world, certain abilities, like that thing that I was mentioning on the back, that essentially gives you the ability to transport from all these hot spots that appear throughout the world. So the second you earn that ability, you just now have that ability, which becomes really useful to get to like hidden rooms or to, you know, maybe tougher boss battles or to find more chests that are hidden throughout the area. That's a thing that you just have forever. So those will be there and those will affect it. How interesting the future ones are, I don't know, but I'm hopeful enough based on what I've seen for sure.
How's the game structured exactly? Is it sort of like different like chambers? You mentioned starting out at the ship. Is it sort of like, how does that work? How's the layout?
Yeah, so you're always starting out at the ship, and there's essentially different biomes you'll be going through. I think for the preview purposes, we can only talk to the first two biomes, and Simon had a luckier run than I did. He beat the boss on his first main run through of the first biome. I did not get so lucky, but so he's seen a little bit more than I have. But essentially, you'll always have a mini map and then a map that you can pull up at any time. That's pretty handy, and you go from room to room. It is a better version of the map from Jedi Fallen Order, if that makes sense. It's sort of presented in that like 3D, like old computer look.
A worse version of the map from Metroid Prime.
Exactly. So we're on the curve again. We're back toward the Metroid Prime map. It's much more easy to navigate this map, to find where you're going, to find what you want. And so, as you can see in any video footage, you usually have a mini map in the lower right hand corner, and that will give you a hint of certain key things like health pickups and like that currency that I mentioned that lets you augment and upgrade your stuff per run. You'll know where doors, both side, essentially like side chambers versus your main chambers are, because you're on the hunt. Once you've crash landed, you're searching for this signal broadcast. And so Selene is always following toward that, but there are obviously other permutations and other hallways that will appear as you go. And you'll see things like right now on the mini map, there's sort of like a little bit of like lines in a little pocket of a room that you can see that form this sort of diamond. That's like a point of interest that you might want to go find. And maybe that's a thing that you can teleport with, or maybe that is a like reserve of a lot of that currency, or that, you know, that alien, the alien resin that you need to upgrade things. Cause you do eventually early on in here get a melee ability. And that's a thing that remains permanent as well. Like I didn't have that on my first run or two, and then I eventually made it far enough. And so then that immediately lets you also open different doors and in that sort of Metroidvania-esque, like get to other chests that you couldn't unlock before. And so there's this good sense of progression and finding your way through it. I've never felt lost in looking through all these rooms or going through it. I feel like I can both take my time in a given room and really search through it, but also keep going and be like, oh, I can always go back there, because you always have a sense of where you've been.
How deep does it feel? Because I get the sense that they're trying to tell a story, but at the same time, that's kind of at odds with the sort of arcadey bullet hell thing they're also throwing at you, and then the roguelite side of it, which is sort of just I never know how roguish something is going to be, you know?
Yeah, that's the thing that I think it might be a little too early to say, if only because like, so obviously it's been in the trailers, and I've seen one, you pop into Selene's childhood or you know, old home on Earth is here randomly in the environment. You'll come across it sometimes, and it's locked though, so when you get to it, so you have to go find a key to unlock it somewhere in the environment. So you could technically ignore that. Like that's not the main quest to go find the signal. You could sort of bypass some of that stuff if you want. Again, a lot of stuff is audio logs and data bank entries. You're also uncovering bits of this alien, the xenoglyph language, to be able to interpret scrawlings on some of the stones that you pass by. You could ignore a lot of that stuff if you want. So if you do just want to run and gun your way through and fight these crazy, you know, like tentacled alien monsters, you can totally do that. I'm really enjoying the like stopping and taking time to find all this stuff and like really search in. Like it's playing to that Metroidvania completionist side of my brain. But if I wasn't doing that, you would still have, I think, a pretty fun Housemarque arcade game. With a little bit more platforming, if that makes sense.
I just want to say how incredibly awesome it is to see Housemarque work on what is absolutely their most ambitious game yet, after the last few years where there was a lot of uncertainty surrounding that studio. There was a lot of sort of frankly depressing, very public interviews where they weren't sure about what was next. I think that like their core philosophy of making just like gorgeous, crazy arcade shooters that have like interesting and unique modernized twists wasn't necessarily connecting on a, you know, multi-million sales record sort of scenario. And so they were doing interviews saying like, hey, we might have to like make some crappy mobile games to keep keep the lights on. And it's just so cool to see them do this, to go from, okay, like we did a lot of shmups and we did a lot of like top-down shooters and, you know, stuff like Rezogun, which I sort of played with the entire kind of sphere, conal approach, to this now, which is just like insane. Like this is totally on a whole nother level from anything they've ever made. And that's a really awesome success story. I hope people support this game. And not just because there's, you know, not a ton of new stuff on PS5 right now, but because it looks awesome and it's unique. And this is the sort of like, this is a fantastic and admirable sort of evolution of what a studio has been working towards for so long. So that kicks ass, man.
The way my chair currently is situated, I feel like I'm your guys' son, who's just like, I'm so excited to talk about games, you guys.
So we actually got you that chair because we have an important announcement. You are our son.
And we're really proud of you, Jonathon.
Oh.
I'm disappointed.
Oh.
He's the angry one.
You keep me humble. I appreciate it, Pa. Thank you to everyone who sat through. This may not matter to you on the watching side, or it might, but we had some technical difficulties, so we're just joining back in. If you're watching the video version, we are now on video. We apologize. We unfortunately lost the video version. The Returnal footage was just too pretty to show. Yeah. And so our recording system said no thank you.
You did miss the first half of the show. We all did the show in the nude.
No, you could only see us from the neck up, so it didn't really matter.
Who's to say one of us isn't bottomless right now? You cannot tell anymore. Okay. There are no rules in 2021.
I'm Winnie the Pooh in it right now.
Okay,
before we get an FTC takedown, Max, you were talking a little bit about Returnal before.
Yeah, so I was going to say, like, my sort of thing with Housemarque Games is I you know, typically go to sort of like interactive worlds to explore, or like narrative stuff, and that's usually at odds with sort of the arcadey approach to things. And like, I definitely mess with Rezogun a fair amount, which is fun, but I find that I don't get like as hooked on that. And I realize that some people are like, you're not a gamer, and it's like, well, okay, I'm after some sort of different type of interactive experience. I don't know what to tell you. And it seems like with Returnal, they're definitely putting way more of an emphasis on the sort of, I guess, the character story world side of things, and I'm really curious about that. I'm just wondering if it's going to click or not. And I mean, the part of the thing is also like with games that are, you know, super arcadey roguelike, is like you can't always see the bottom, you know. And it's like, is it a game that you're going to beat, or is it a game you're just going to kind of peter out on?
Yeah, that's definitely, I think, one of the biggest questions for me is just how deep will this experience go. And as I was saying, like, I can definitely see myself playing for, you know, 5 or 6 more hours easily, but will I play for 30 or 40? I don't quite know yet, but I hope so. It gives me a lot of hope.
You mentioned the DualSense and the 3D audio stuff. How are the load times? Because that's obviously the big thing the PS5 is supposed to be good at.
Super quick so far. Like, the game runs really smoothly and looks gorgeous. Like we were saying before, particle effects and everything is something we know Housemarque for, and that translates to this game, but just in a prettier, more refined environment. Like the time from dying to being back into sort of the crash sequence is pretty immediate. Like, I have, you just asking me made me realize I have not even recognized that there were load times. So if they exist, and obviously I'll go back and check, but they were extraordinarily quick. When you're doing the sort of like fast travel teleporting thing, there's essentially like an animation of you using the alien technology, and then it cuts to you at the other location, and it's pretty near instant. So far it's been a breeze, and that's essential for something like this, because if you're hung up in between runs, if you're waiting for a load, you're gonna stop very quickly. But this has not caused that whatsoever. Definitely, as I said, go check out Simon's written and video preview. They're really, really great and give you a great snapshot of Returnal. And I'm excited to talk about this one more.
Game's out in like a week, right?
Yeah, April 30th. So, coming up really soon. And it is the start of, I think, of a bit more of a cadence of big releases that are coming out. So we're going to have a lot to talk about in the next few weeks. But moving on from there, I briefly wanted to mention news going out the day that we're recording this. there is a new partnership that PlayStation has announced with a company called ProbablyMonsters, and specifically Firewalk Studios within this company. So ProbablyMonsters is a group that was formed a few years back, and they have three studios. And Firewalk Studios is working on a AAA, you know, massive multiplayer game, not MMO necessarily, but just a huge multiplayer experience. And Sony has announced that they are going to be the publishing partner for this, and you know, essentially the exclusive publishing partner for this game. What this game is isn't announced just yet, but Firewalk has a ton of pedigree to it, despite being a name you probably haven't heard before. It includes a ton of people, including the leadership of the studio being people from Bungie, with Destiny devs in there. There's also devs from Call of Duty, Apex Legends, Halo, Mass Effect. There is a lot of you know, talent clearly at the studio. A cool thing that when I was researching this team and ProbablyMonsters overall is that they are very also focused on a sustainable dev environment. And obviously that can sound like a lot of buzzwords, but like a core part of their identity. And I actually did an interview with a few of the leads of the studio, as well as Herman Holst, which you can read on IGN right now. They were talking a lot about, like, for them and, you know, the studio, they've been incubating and working on things since like 2018, 2017, somewhere in there. They've really been about putting the devs and their health first. And, you know, obviously in an era where crunch is a constant discussion point for some of the biggest games, that's a very, very nice thing to say. And of course, putting that into practice is what matters most. And so I'm excited to see where the studio goes from here, because certainly talking to them, I get the sense that they're very much in a, like, they want the devs to feel like this is an encouraging, safe environment, but also want to make sure they're working on stuff they actually like working on. Which is a pretty good combination of things. And as silly and obvious as that might sound, it's nice to hear that sort of at the forefront of what that studio is about. They're less so, when I spoke to their leads, it was less so like, we want to turn the multiplayer experience on its head and do something like never before. Like, obviously they want to do big things, but their approach to talking about things was always from the developer side of it first. And I appreciated hearing that message from them and hearing about that. As for this partnership, again, just wanted to mention, go check out my interview with Herman Holst. First time I've actually gotten to speak with him, as well as the lead of the studio. It was a really great chat, sort of about why this partnership made sense. And I kind of wanted to bring this up just because I think, like, right now PlayStation is in a really weird multiplayer situation. I don't know how you guys feel, but I sort of asked them, like, yeah, and specifically Herman, I was like, you know, there are multiplayer games within the Sony first party studios. We know that Naughty Dog is working on something multiplayer. Gran Turismo obviously has multiplayer. But beyond that, it hasn't been as big of a focus. So why this? And they said that what brought them and ProbablyMonsters together, and Firewalk specifically, is that they're both really interested in storytelling within that space. And obviously Sony first party studios are very focused on storytelling. And so what the team wants to do, not just in telling the story of this world that they're creating in this IP, but also to let players tell that story, is like paramount to them for what they want to build. That's a lot of like high level talk, I realize, and obviously leaves both of you guys sort of like, well, I'll read the interview, but it's more, I wanted to point that out just for people to go check that out. And also just to bring it up, like, it's weird because I feel like multiplayer on PlayStation, like, we've seen experiments in the past, like MAG on PS3, or obviously SOCOM was bigger back in the day. Stuff like PlayStation All-Stars Battle Royale came out, but right now multiplayer hasn't been a huge paramount to PlayStation Studios. So I'm curious what you guys feel about them seeking partnerships to kind of bring that into the space.
Good. Go for it.
Yeah.
All right. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. You know, not my go-to sort of genre or game style or anything like that. I'm very happy with their, you know, catalog of story-driven, cinematic, third-person action-adventure games starring sad fathers. I'm way into that. That's awesome. I connect with a lot of those things. But I think the the greater industry at large and consumers in general gravitate towards multiplayer, spend tons of money on them. It's obviously a risky thing because you want to make a game that people will connect with for a very long time. And I think there's a finite amount of games that people can play like that. But then again, if you look at something like Outriders, right, like that connected with a lot of people. You can play through the entire game with a single player campaign, but you can also squad up with your friends and go grind for loot into the end game for dozens and dozens of hours. It looks like it sold well on MPD. So I'm into something like that. Like I hope that they can create a lot of things that kind of bridge that gap that aren't just like purely multiplayer, but stuff where like a couple of us can get together and play through a big game like that. I dig it.
I mean, as you can tell by that probably like deafening pause that resulted in you saying go for it, I thought you were talking to me. I was like, okay, I guess I'll talk about multiplayer. No, with this, what I hear here when they're saying they want to tell stories through multiplayer is games as a service. Like they want to build ecosystems for people to exist in, as opposed to being like, here's a box you go out and buy. It's $60. You play it until you get sick of it. Like they want to have obviously that loop that keeps people coming back. That's kind of the name of the game right now. And you know, it's not always just like we've seen Call of Duty, like Warzone, for instance, go from being like, yeah, 100 people get dropped in and 99 of them die and the other one gets a new gun or whatever. It goes from that to being like, all right, we're going to have some like ATV races. You can just hang out with a friend, just sit on a train, just go around in circles for a while. Like it's become much more of like a social space. Obviously, Fortnite does some of that, too. It's going to be interesting to sort of see how storytelling is incorporated into that, because I mean, you see that with like the new seasons of Fortnite or, you know, the new seasons of Call of Duty or whatever. They roll out like a little cutscene and you kind of have like some idea of what the, you know, what the world is going through. I'm curious what they mean when they like, we want kind of players to be a part of that. Obviously, players have to be a part of it, because if they're not, it's not a multiplayer game. It's just exists in a void. It's curious. I feel like Sony's earlier stuff in terms of, you know, multiplayer, with the exceptions of, I mean, I guess like PlayStation Home and maybe Dreams, has been pretty conventional. Like you're dropped into a match with other people and you fight them and then it's over. You know, it's not like a consistent ongoing thing. So I like that. I mean, it sounds like they're kind of not playing it safe, but like kind of taking their time and hopefully it's not just spitting out something that's redundant and designed by committee in a hope to kind of grab, you know, some of the attention of other people who are playing other games. But Brian, you hit the nail on the head. Like it becomes a kind of a battle royale between different games of like who can you know, dominate a person's attention span. Like obviously time is finite. And when you've got, you know, I think that was one of the big complaints about like a recent, you know, Destiny expansion, was that like you have to be a certain level to do the raid, which is the thing that makes it exciting and fun. And that's like an ongoing issue of like, you have to basically, you know, you have to do homework to do the fun part, which I think some people are over, you know,
which I mean, it always leaves me personally in this weird sort of like netherworld between like, do I like a big game like that drops, right? Like Outriders happen, and I played a bunch before the game launched and I really dug it, and the game came out and everybody was like, it's not loading, it's got problems, and I was like, I'll wait until it's fixed. And then I think it's fixed, but like people either moved on or they're like super high level, and I never know the right time to jump in. We like talked a couple weeks ago about that rumored, you know, Last of Us 1 remake to coincide with the HBO show. I think that like taking The Last of Us multiplayer and really putting a lot of like effort into it and turning it into something where there's not just, you know, like Max was describing before, of like going into a match, winning the match or losing the match, and then the match is over, but creating these sort of like events and tentpole moments that are based around narrative and going, hey, this weekend there's a huge horde, or there's like this infestation, or like a new villain is in this Seattle coffee shop. We all got to go kill him, or something like that. You know, JJ Abrams is here to show his new film. some crap like that. Like Fortnite does a really good job of that. Apex recently announced that they are effectively continuing the story, the narrative of Titanfall 2 in their multiplayer. Stuff like that is so cool. Like taking traditional multiplayer modes and stretching them out so that they create a narrative and a single player story of their own is really, really interesting. Like I don't check back on these games often, but like And PUBG was never really like it was a little too like sort of aggressively military for me. And I don't know the last time you guys booted that game up, but I loaded it like a week ago just to be like, where are you guys at? And I'm in the lobby and it's basically like it's like dollar store Fortnite at this point. Like there are like there's like clowns running around, like actual people in clown. I think they started off with like a bunch of like kind of gruff military guys, a bunch of ball guys with aviators that look like me. And then now you jump in there and it's just like nonsense and it's fun, you know, and that's how this sort of like that's how you stretch a game out to really go on and on and on. And I hope that's something we get to see from Sony, because they have a lot of universes where it makes sense for them to do stuff like that. And I think they're adapting those stories specifically to single player. And like we said before about like finite resources, I don't think that one takes away from the other. There was a very like mid-2000s approach and philosophy around game design. That multiplayer modes were only tacked on because they needed to make money, because otherwise people would sell the games, and they would take away from the single player campaign. And I think we're in a different spot now. I think that like a lot of teams, especially something like Naughty Dog, wrapped up a huge project last year, and now they have a team that's, you know, a smaller team focusing on Last of Us multiplayer, and they're probably ramping up towards whatever other story they're telling next. But yeah, why not go all in on multiplayer and make something really, really cool that single player fans can connect with too? I dig.
Yeah, it's a really interesting space right now, and I think yeah, whatever happens with Naughty Dog's multiplayer experience, I hope we get something from there, because I loved Factions and hope we see something there. But yeah, with Firewalk, I definitely think, speaking to all that stuff that you guys were saying, like the pedigree of the studio coming from Apex and Destiny and you know, those sorts of multiplayer games that are now really integrating a lot of story in there is exciting to me as someone who dabbles in those, as you guys were saying. But I'm always fascinated by hearing about these stories too. Like I think it's also a way to get a wider audience interested in your game, even if they don't end up playing it, but being aware of it. And you know, just general awareness can help a lot. So I'm really excited to see what comes from the studio. We don't sort of have a timeline for benchmarks of when we'll see stuff. But as I said, definitely go check out my interview on IGN to learn more about this partnership. Before we move on, just briefly also wanted to mention, because this leak happened, and as happens, I assume we're going to probably get an official announcement by the time the show goes up. But Sony seemed to have accidentally teased a PlayStation Plus Video Pass. So not a Game Pass, as many may have hoped, but the PlayStation Poland website added and then quickly removed a banner that showed off this new service that seems to be part of PlayStation Plus, a trial service available for the next year that will allow PlayStation Plus users, at least in Poland, according to this, to access some films, possibly TV content as well, in addition to whatever PlayStation Plus normally offers them. The banner showed Venom, Zombieland, Double Tap, and Bloodshot, which, quality of any of those films aside, very clearly points to this being a synergy thing with Sony Pictures. And I think them adding, you know, incentives for reasons to care about PlayStation Plus, it's a little funny, because it's like, well, people kind of want a Game Pass equivalent. This is not that, but this is also something that they can offer that Xbox necessarily can't, because Xbox doesn't have a movies and TV wing that's as involved in development, because they kind of pushed that away after the Xbox One launch. Obviously, the, you know, the Halo show is coming and whatnot, but as we move it into an era where we're going to see a lot of these adaptations, like the Uncharted movie later this year or next year, whenever it's coming out, The Last of Us show, the Ghost of Tsushima movie, the Twisted Metal show, and probably more things to be announced. Like, this is a smart way of bringing all that stuff together under one roof for PlayStation fans. It's especially when they're not going to allow you to buy movies and TV from your PlayStation anymore. This seems like probably the best middle ground for that. I don't know how you guys feel about it, but
yeah, no, you're right. This feels like a sort of direct reaction or response to the news from a couple weeks ago about sort of sunsetting those, you know, movie services. I also think this is huge news for the millions of people all over the planet that forgot that they made a second Zombieland movie, like I did.
I saw that and I forgot it existed.
Did you really?
I've never seen it.
No, it's totally one of those, like, it's, they just did it again with other people. It's weird. I completely forgot about that. Airplane
or,
movie.
Or Bloodshot, which was the last movie kind of to come out in theaters before the pandemic.
Yeah, that's right, man. See, I they're in an interesting spot here. If this is the kind of, if this does come into fruition, if this is the kind of service that's gets tacked on to pre-existing PlayStation Plus subscriptions as an added value, awesome. Yes, yep. That's exactly what I want. In terms of like spinning out yet the umpteenth standalone streaming service from a specific studio, no thank you. Like I want the money back that I spent seeing Venom in theaters. No offense to people who, I think there's some funny stuff in that movie. But I don't think that I would spend like $8 or $12 a month watching Bloodshot, Zombieland 2, Venom. And then, I mean, hypothetically, the Spider-Mans, like everything is such an illegal minefield. The Spider-Mans.
Thank you.
Because the Spider-Man movies, the newer ones that are ostensibly connected to the MCU, but not like legally part of they're like part of that, like Sony Pictures presents a Marvel cinematic logo or whatever. Those are going to Netflix. And so I think there was, I don't know if that's like an exclusivity deal or whatever, but that's happening there. And so they're not on Disney Plus. I don't want this to be a thing where I just watch Sony Pictures things. Like when the Paramount Plus thing happened, I kind of groaned, but then I was like, oh yeah, you have like MTV, Comedy Central, Nickelodeon, like there's a lot of access there. And I'm sure there's a bunch of stuff under Sony's umbrella that I'm totally forgetting, but like the Twisted Metal TV show that doesn't have like a cast yet, or Zombieland 2 or Bloodshot, that's not enough for me. But if you just go, hey, you have PlayStation Plus, you can watch Bloodshot for free, then all of a sudden I'm like, that's exactly what Bloodshot's worth. Sure. You know, make the value better. You know, that's what a thing I love about Game Pass. It's like they add stuff to it, you know, and it makes it better. That's,
you know,
that's
when
all
you get
I want.
A collector's edition and there's like the big, you know, nice statue, and then there's like the enamel pins, and there's a cloth map, and then there's like 5 exclusive art cards, and it's just like, yeah, it's just postcards. Like if they treat the movies like the postcards for PlayStation Plus, and it's like, yeah, you get a AAA game, you get a AAA game for PlayStation 5, you get a smaller indie game that maybe you already own, and then there's also Venom. Like that would be such a great like added value tidbit, because I feel like it's kind of a drop in the bucket in terms of you know, them already, they've already gotten their money's worth several times over on something like Venom. And I feel like tacking it on to PlayStation Plus is just like, hey, you also get a movie. That would be rad if they're like, for an extra $2.99, you'll also get some movies from Sony. I'm just like, no, I have enough subscription stuff already tacked on. It's fine.
It's,
like,
it's definitely going to have to be something I think that is just additive to what we already have. I think the second they're like, yeah, and for $5 more, like I'm out. Especially because presumably, again, we'll find out more if you're watching the video version, there's a logo that appeared on this, like this is very clearly something that was in the works to some certain extent. We'll probably find out more soon, but I do think it needs to be something that is adding on to your PlayStation Plus subscription to give you more of a reason to have that, and it needs to be more than those 3 movies. But like, as long as it is a thing that's like, yeah, each month you get another movie and a TV show that you can watch or something like that, that's great. Like that, just to find more ways to add things. If it's, you know, the 5th season of CBS's SWAT that they produce at Sony Pictures, I am less inclined to care. But like, it'll definitely matter what they add to this. But it is, I think it's a smart approach when PlayStation has become such the dominant force at Sony, compared to like their other entertainment brands, and finding ways to integrate this stuff beyond Spider-Man into the PlayStation structure is probably a smart move.
The logo looks like a razor blade right now, so they should probably do something about that. Also, yeah. I actually, Max, you were saying I sort of like the, like Jack in the Box is a trash tier fast food restaurant that has all these like 3 a.m. stoner combo meals. Where they're just like, hey, you guys want teriyaki chicken and a taco and a double cheeseburger with jalapenos on it? I feel like that's where PlayStation Plus is going to be, where they're like, you get a PS5 game, a PS4 game, a PSVR game, and a movie. Like, all right, sure, great.
Why the hell not? Mix it up. I mean, it's interesting. You look at sort of how the different streaming services are handling things, and like, I mean, Paramount Plus's movie lineup kind of sucks, and then you know, but their TV shows, their TV lineup is massive. And then you look at like Amazon, and like Amazon Prime Video is like, you also get free shipping on a bunch of crap you probably didn't need to order while you were on the toilet. And then like
Venom on
yeah,
DVD.
Exactly. And then there's also like, there's music and there's like Audible stuff. There's all these different little tendrils of other things they've acquired. And like the fact that Sony does have, like, they have different wings. Like Microsoft doesn't have this. Nintendo doesn't have this. They don't have like a movie portion, whereas like Sony does. And it would be cool as hell if they managed to kind of maybe synergistically do something with that, because a lot of people do watch movies on their PlayStation devices. That's a reality. That's a thing we've known about for quite some time at this point. Yeah, I don't know. Do you remember when the PlayStation Vita was about to come out? And I think it was still being very rumored. It was like the PSP2. And there were the two models. There was the Wi-Fi one, and there's also the 3G one, which you'd have to get a phone plan to use mobile stuff with. Meanwhile, there was also the Xperia Play, which was like the Sony Ericsson yeah. mobile gaming phone. And people were like, wait, which is the PlayStation phone? And it was one of those things where it's like you have this company with two different arms doing two very similar things, but no one's talking to each other in the right sense. It was a totally baffling, you know, situation there where like some in a perfect world, you know, Sony could have come out and be like, hey, we made a PlayStation phone. You can play PlayStation 1 games on it and also new indie games. Check it out. And also call your mom. And it's like, that didn't happen. We didn't have that. We had like a weird two sort of half-baked handheld situations. And I don't know, like maybe, you know, get people from the PlayStation side of things on the Sony picture side of things and be like, hey, I mean, if they were like, for an extra $5 a month, you get everything that Sony Pictures is doing, I would be intrigued, you know, if it was on top of the existing PlayStation Plus subscription. Another thing, maybe people who have PlayStation Plus don't want to pay a full price subscription to watch Spider-Man on Netflix or The Last of Us on HBO Max. Maybe they have some like, you know, clause in the contracts that makes those things happen where they're like, also, we want to put those on our platform as well. Like if they come out and they're like, hey, great news, everybody. The Last of Us, The Last of Us 2, and also the first three episodes of The Last of Us HBO series are on PlayStation Plus this month. That would get people mm-hmm. talking about The Last of Us. And it would, you know,
And I feel like, I don't know, something like Bloodshot as an added value is probably content quality wise equal to one of the D tier Xbox 360 games that gets thrown into Games with Gold every month. Like, I love this. I think this is awesome. You find a bunch of old garbage in the garage and you repurpose, you put it all on the table, you repurpose it. I'm into it.
Well, if you loved Maquette, you'll love Venom on PlayStation Plus this month. We'll obviously see, again, given our luck, this will definitely be announced in between when we record and when this episode goes up. So feel free to laugh at us in the comments. But if it becomes real, we'll talk about it more in the future. Brian, I know you're on a bit of a timetable, so if you need to bounce, please just say so and we can let you bounce at any point. But just to sort of wrap up, wanted to briefly touch on what we're playing, and just because of time constraints, Brian, I'll start with you. Anything you've been playing recently that you wanted to shout out?
Sure. I played the Resident Evil 8 demo over the weekend in that bizarre window of 8 hours between like 5 p.m. and 3 a.m. with a 30-minute time limit exclusively on PlayStation products. You know, the way you're supposed to experience marketing games. Devices.
Yeah, I totally missed it. So I'm curious to hear what you thought.
Yeah, it was, you know, I'm not in love with the way that was rolled out. But once I played it, I enjoyed it. I hate playing games with a gun in my head, with a timer over me, especially, you know, a horror, like survival horror game where I want to creep around and look at everything. I think I talked about when they put that first demo out a couple months ago, I spent like, most people can beat that thing like 10 minutes. And I think I spent like an hour and 15 minutes with it, just kind of poking around, looking at textures, picking up items and rotating them. And there's so much of that in Resident Evil that I love. This demo is awesome. It really shows sort of the breadth of what this game is going to be doing here. It gave me like really awesome sort of vintage folk horror movie vibes, which I'm really into that genre. When Midsommar came out a couple years ago, I kind of did a deep dive on Wicker Man and, you know, what is Blood from Satan's Claw and a bunch of there's all these just like insane old sort of vintage horror movies that take place in a very kind of like weird, you know, helpless scenario where a guy shows up to a town and was like, what's going on here? And then finds out that everyone is terrible and in a cult. Resident Evil 4 does that extraordinarily well. Resident Evil 5 does that less well, but still pretty well. And this game is awesome. Like you show up in this incredibly detailed, dilapidated place that is sort of run down, overgrown with tall weeds, and there are just locked doors everywhere. It's just like immediately there's all these different directions you can go, all these different things you can interact with, horrible people, just rusted, run down old environments and items and stuff like that. I love it. I love it so much. I think that the setting is going to be really, really cool. The demo does a really good job of showing off interacting with items, finding weapons. There's a bit of crafting in there that I believe you can do. I didn't get to do it in the time, but I picked up a lot of parts. You know, there's weird old doors that can only be opened with random shapes and devices. There's combat, which they throw a bunch of awful leaping werewolf men at you in the tall grass. I don't jump scare a lot, but there was definitely like, I got to get the F out of here as fast as possible. It's just fun. It's super cool. They bring you into a sort of small house where there's a bunch of sort of survivors kind of banding together to stay alive. One of them has been bitten or hurt. You can guess how that goes. And so, yeah, I love this. I'm done looking at this game now. I don't think I'm going to look at any more promotional material. I don't want to see any more demos. I know they're going to make more demos readily available.
There's a second one. Yeah.
Yeah. There's a second one coming. I plan on reneging everything I'm saying right now and downloading it, but, I'm sold. I'm so into this. I still don't really like Ethan as a protagonist. I feel like he does that thing that every Resident Evil character does, whereby, you know, this is his now second time spending 30, 40 hours in a place that is overrun with awful, and he's still just constantly, and Leon did this, Chris has done this, Jill's done this, where they're like, what the heck was that? Like, there's just, it's like, nothing should surprise you anymore, honestly, man. I'm not crazy about him as a protagonist, but I don't care. He's a vessel for this world, which I will be interacting with in first person, as you all will, because that's the way the game's designed. I think that does like a really good job of helping to tell the story here. I think that like Resident Evil 7 being based primarily in like two pretty enclosed environments was sort of like a narrative handcuff that, you know, you were kind of like, why would you spend this much time here? You are looking for someone. But here it's like you are in this massive sprawling place. There are mountains in the distance. There are castles in a different distance. There are different winding paths that you can hypothetically go down. I'm so in. I can't wait for this game. I really, really can't wait for this game to come out. That's all.
I got a question for you. How long did it take you to download the demo?
Really quickly. Like it was quick.
More than half an hour or less than half an hour?
Less than that.
You're ruining his joke here.
You're on fiber internet. No, I feel like unsurprisingly, I also didn't get a chance to play it. I think it's a very odd approach because I can't imagine anyone who is on the fence about this game. Obviously, like the demo is a bunch of fan service because only a fan of this would go through the trouble of figuring out what time zone the game was available in for them and that they could download it and then spend the time to download it and then rush through it in 30 minutes. It's just such an odd, like, I don't know. I feel like if you're trying to get people on board with this fairly kooky locale for a otherwise very proven series, maybe make it more accessible. Maybe make it easier for people to check it out and play it. Maybe make a smaller demo that you can play more. I guess that's what's coming out, but yeah.
You shouldn't need an infographic, basically. And I don't want to complain about like a free thing that a company ultimately let me experience, but it is demos are a marketing tool. And I don't think you should need an infographic to explain how and when and where and why and what.
No, I mean, let's be realistic here. They successfully created the digital version of waiting in line to play this at PAX East.
Yes,
that's so there it is.
Except nobody farted on me.
That's I mean, you have a kid
that
who
you
knows?
Know of.
That's true.
I'm so stoked on this game. I don't know if I said this. I think I forgot. I was on paternity leave. I played through the new one or the old seven, whatever, but the
seven,
mansion one. Yeah. And I heeded your advice, Brian. And the second I got to the boat, I was like, I will stop playing. And I watched the rest of it on YouTube. And I was like, I'm glad I didn't play that. It looked like a lot of muddy tunnels, which are not the best part of that game, but that was a cool as hell game. It was a good time.
Yeah,
a lot of fun. I'm right there with you on Ethan. I think he's kind of a wiener kid.
He is. Yeah, as Brian said, I feel like he is definitely the vessel to explore the rest of this. I wish they could make him a little more interesting since, you know, he's not like a silent protagonist. But I'm the same way as Max. I missed it as well. But I'm excited to just jump into this. We're so close. I keep forgetting it is like 2 weeks away at this point, but this has me excited in a way that I haven't been for a horror game, especially in quite some time. So yeah, I'm looking forward to this one.
Between this and Returnal, it's like this is the, these are like two games that are extremely my ish, and it's like finally some food, you know. Finally.
Yeah. Max, what about you? Anything you've been playing that you want to
It's been a light gaming week and a very heavy diaper week, so I've been kind of busy with that, but more Disco Elysium, still chipping away at that game. I really love it. I think the load times are borderline unforgivable. Like, that is a very good game at its core, but it is also a predominantly text-based, like fairly low poly Unity game that has you going back and forth and talking to different people. And there's a part I'm at where you have to go, basically there's like the downstairs bar and then there's a person who's up on one of the top floors, and to get from, and you basically go back and forth and you're like, well, so-and-so said this, did so-and-so say this to you, and you do the whole comparison good cop bad cop thing. To go between these people, there are I think 4 or 5 load screens, which are not insubstantial load times, which I feel like I'm totally willing to be like, hey, this isn't a dedicated PS5 game. This is a PS4 game that's running on PS5. It's, you know, it's a PC game. Maybe it wasn't optimized. The controls are a little bit weird. It's just, it's such a good game and I want to keep powering through it. But like having to put the controller down and just like straight up wait for a load screen to burn through is like not what I was hoping for from next gen. And I don't know. I feel like it's just bad optimization at this point. And I don't know how to make games, but like look at this game and tell me that like this shouldn't have negligible load times on a next gen console. It's just annoying. It's kind of a bummer. So I hopefully can get back into that. I did mess around a bit more in FF14. I don't know if I'll stick it out. I really want to.
What about the guild?
I might if we do that, I might be able to try to hop in and stuff. But it does a thing, and it's really hard for me to kind of explain this. It does a thing that I hate in video games where it doesn't feel like a real place. Like it feels like it's levels, not a space. And I keep getting lost because it's laid out like a fake castle. Like it doesn't feel like it's not that it doesn't feel lived there. It feels like it wasn't designed for people to live there. And I have a hard time kind of properly for, obviously it's not an issue because millions of people have had a great time in that game, and obviously it's my problem, but I don't know. There's a bit in Punch Drunk Love where Adam Sandler gets like lost in an apartment complex and he's just running around going to different doors and he's like freaking out. Imagine that, but it's like a gnome in a castle, and that was what I was doing. So
there are a ton of like, hey, look at this point on your minimap, or just thousands of doorways to go through to get to the same places, or levels that you're not expecting to climb through. So I can definitely very much sympathize with that. Yeah, I've played a bit because my girlfriend surprisingly fell in love with it. She's level 45 now, and is just absolutely loving it. She's playing, I think, a monk and really enjoying it. So I've been a healer for her team, and it is definitely something that works with friends. So yeah, if we can work to maybe get a Beyond Guild together, that could be
carry
a fun
my
way to
ass
play
I through. Keep getting killed by toads and lost in the hallway.
We'll save you from those toads. I've got great healing spells and nothing else. But that's about going to do it for this week's episode of Podcast Beyond. Thank you, Brian and Max, so much for joining me for this week's episode. You can find us all on Twitter. I am at JM Dornbush, Brian is at Agent Bizzle, and Max is at Max Scoville. Thank you so much to Red, our producer, as always, for helping to make this show run, even when the programs we use don't want it to. And of course, thank you to everyone out there for listening and watching to this wonderful show that we love to make for all of you. We hope you're safe. We hope you're well. And as always, beyond.
Beyond.